Should I wait or can I start?
Do you need that fan? It will make, it will catch that.
No, I don't need some.
So, have a little, have this.
So, a warm welcome to all of you here. So, today's presentation of mine is relating to role of homeopathy in COVID-19 curative and preventive. So what I will be discussing today in my presentation, I'm just giving an outline of my today's presentation. Definition and brief details of COVID-19 medical facts. Explanation of certain terms in context to epidemic, a reference from Organon and philosophy. Disease as per homeopathy and classification of disease. Acute disease classification, as in epidemic, how to derive it, and the genus epidemicus. Role of homeopathic medicine as prophylactic medicine and curative, that is artificial susceptibility. Then role of homeopathy in recurrences and my experiences in COVID-19 cases as a curative medicine. If there is any part which has been already explained by any of the stuff, you can ask me to skip that. I would do that. It's better not to have a repetition, that's what I thought. So how to approach such epidemic cases? The first thing is the details of disease manifestations. So as all of us are well aware, and it is, you know, continuously coming past last year relating to the news and COVID, all of us, even the lay persons, are aware of what are the signs and symptoms. But as a physician, we should have certainly an upper hand in relating to know what are the disease manifestations. Then classification of the disease. As per it's an acute condition, all of us know it, and an epidemic condition. We have to classify the disease and diagnose it to understand the stage and integrated intervention if required. We should be even able to understand if there is any integrated intervention is required for us in our cases if we have to manage it at a practical setup. And there are certain tables which helps us in knowing the criteria, which cases are our limitations and which cases we can go forward. So assessments of cases which can be treated or shifted to hospital, those are the red flags. So these comes in a daily basis because the stages and of the disease keeps on changing. So what best we can offer as homeopaths? If we speak relating to curative, all of us are very well aware relating to the symptom similarity and acute totality formation. And coming to the potency selection, we know the factor of susceptibility which is involved. Then prophylactic, even our college has done, and all over India, relating to arsenic album, 30 years of prophylactic, okay, has already been distributed, okay, and we know about it. And keen observation of my own relating to the 7th day. So when the patient starts getting the symptoms, I've observed in my cases and many people which we had interaction with, from 7th day the symptom starts getting bad or worse. So that 7th day is a day of caution, wherein we have to, when we are looking our patients, we have to be extra cautious relating to the relating from 7th day. So as we know, relating to the global public health emergency of COVID-19 pandemic disease, so all of us know COVID-19 is a disease, and the virus is severe acute respiratory corona virus 2. So it is an RNA virus and corona viridia group, and this is mainly because of human frequent cross species infections. All of us have details relating to this. So, do I need to explain the structure of it? Okay. So the incubation time, the median incubation period is 5.8 days, and range reported is 2.1 to 11.1 days. That is an average which was taken. So the probable time of quarantine which was given was 14 days. So origin is from the bats, and on March 2020, there was an assessment of coronavirus as pandemic from WHO. So the main important thing over here we have to understand is, it's given in the website from the WHO itself, that it is suggested that even though patients of all ages are susceptible to it, individual developing critical illness were older with a greater number of comorbid conditions. So men were majorly affected, and the conditions are older, and the cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, myelitis, hypertension, coronary heart disease, cancers, and COPD. So there is a very direct relation relating to who is susceptible to this COVID-19 infection. So this was the common symptomatology which we have come across. The COVID-19, that's fever, cough, shortness of breath, myalgia, fatigue, sputum production, headache, hemoptysis, diarrhea, respiratory rate greater than 24 breaths per minute, confusion, rhinorrhea, chest pain, nausea. So all of these complaints we are well aware of. So these are the five clinical syndromes of SARS-CoV-2. Okay. So while we are going to prescribe any medicine as a curative, okay. See, curative relating to that, we had not got permissions. But there are certain patients who will approach to you and they are okay to do, okay, with the treatment along with the measures whatever they are taking. When we have been given a chance, certainly this criteria should be known to us. The first thing is uncomplicated illness. These are the majority of cases relating to the curative cases which we get in our practice. That is, patients will be with upper respiratory tract infections. So these cases were very common and we were not able to distinguish whether it was a common cold, influenza-like condition, or whether it was any upper respiratory tract infection. It had resemblance to most of the complaints, and these are the patients who are roaming around which we see, right? So these are the uncomplicated illness. Second is the mild pneumonia. They did not have severe pneumonia, but when they went for a CT scan lung, they saw the presence of certain opacities which were seen. Third condition is the severe pneumonia which the patient were presenting. Herein the patient had respiratory infection and SpO2 was less than 90 in room air. Okay. So having an information relating to SpO2 also is very important in such cases, because we have to know on giving oxygen and without that what should be the level of maintaining the patient. Then acute respiratory distress syndrome, sepsis and septic shock. These are the five criteria which we have to know, and if any patient is coming, either of we have to put our patients into those criteria, and by this we are going to understand whether we have been able to take this case or we have to refer, and at which step we have to send the patient. This will help us in that. Now coming to the homeopathic aspects, as homeopaths, many people would have asked us, what is the role and what you have read in your organ or running your homeopathy. So certainly we should know there are certain facts which have been already told by Dr. Hahnemann, like it's like almost 200 years. All the facts were known by him. There was no microscope, but still certain facts were known, right? We should be really very proud relating to those facts, because these things were witnessed in a very prior time than today, okay? Now, in spite of having electron microscope, we are able to view things. He had seen these organisms because mainly it was based on the observation. There was no virology, there was no microscope, but in spite of that, things were known. So slowly as days are approaching, everyone is understanding that whatever is disease is mainly because derangement of something. It's not something pathological, it's something derangement of the vital force. Okay. So in the aphorism number 9, they speak relating to derangement of the vital force by a dynamic influence of a morbific agent inimical to life. So all of us know that something which is not fine to our body, which is inimical, that is definitely going to cause derangement. So the factors that derange the vital force are the prima causa morbi. The thing which derange our vital force are prima causa morbi. That is what as homeopaths we need to look into. The bacteria, viruses, these are all secondary causes. We have to know what makes us susceptible, so these organisms come and affect our body. So speaking in modern terms, because philosophy will not be taken very well by the people. That's because people want everything scientific. So coming to that point, in modern terms, when vital force is deranged, the normal physiology is disturbed. Homeostasis is disturbed, and the body tends to have altered sensations and functions, which in course of time manifest magnifies and gets into pathology. So we know in the aphorism number 5, there is something called as an exciting cause which is responsible for an acute disease. And while treating acute disease, one of the most important causes to know is the exciting cause. So what is that? It is the one which make body susceptible to illness. Okay, so this can give us a very good explanation that why everyone did not get COVID-19. We all of us came from June, I guess. June 1st we started. We sat in the OPDs, we came, we met people, everything. But we did not, we traveled as well. But we did not get. That's because either we went asymptomatic because of our susceptibility, or it would be we are not prone to it. Okay. So there are innumerable factors which disturb our homeostasis, which make us prone to illness, and that excite our susceptibility. So this is not a process of today. It is a process which is happening from a genetics. It's something acquired. So many things it deals with us and makes us what we are today. So in order to investigate of acute cases, or to have such existed for a short time, and it's easiest for physicians. So if you get an acute case, it's very easy for us to prescribe, because your patients will be having everything very much fresh into their memory and they can very easily tell us. While in chronic case, they have to remember, they have to go back into that memory lane and remember all of these things. But it does not necessarily happen in the acute cases. So selection of acute remedy along with exciting cause, the presenting symptoms also should be considered. This is something which is very important. So aphorism number 30 to 33 speaks relating to the susceptibility. Here they speak that Hahnemann says disease do not affect human beings unconditionally. The organism must be predisposed to it and must be in a susceptible state for the disease to affect or manifest in organism. It's very simple. Disposed in the sense we are genetically born with that acquired thing, okay, which we have genetically acquired. And susceptible means it's a stage of lower vitality or resistance wherein you will acquire disease conditions. So we are born with disposition, and disposition manifests when you are in a susceptible state. Okay, that means we all have a disposition, but only when you are susceptible, only at that time the disease will start appearing. Okay, so many diseases appears, in a genetics we know that, right? So many diseases are present. But we will get that, for example, if my father is having hypertension, as soon as I'm born, why I don't get it? Because I'm not susceptible to it. I may be susceptible early than him, I may be susceptible at a later stage. That is a defense mechanism of ourselves, how we are leading our life, what we are eating, how much exercise we do, what is our stress going on. All of these things will get that disposition and make us in a stage of susceptibility. Why I'm talking all of this is directly relating to our COVID-19. Apart from susceptibility and disposition, even virulence of causative microbe is important. Concept of microbes was not in Dr. Hahnemann's time. So this is something which we have to know. We cannot even, completely be there. Whatever new things are happening today, that also we should consider. One of that is the virulence. Okay, that is very important. So there is a concept by Dr. Kent. He says that contagion and consequently in cases cured, there is practically one dose administered, or at least which is sufficient to cause a suspension of the influx. This means whenever you are going to fall sick, okay, there is something, a factor which is called as a low resistance. If you are having low resistance, definitely it will come and affect you. Okay, that is what they are saying. And once you are resistant, no infection will enter your body. So like this, Stuart Close also has spoken, and even relating to H.A. Roberts also has given the description relating to susceptibility. So we are the vacuum. So if anyone is falling sick, we are not going to say that, "Arey, I got infection from you." It's because you are responsible, you are susceptible, you are getting. Usually what happens, I even tell in the class, that if anyone is falling sick, they usually complain their bench partner. "Arey, you got infection and from you I got." It's not like that. You are susceptible, you are disposed, and that infection comes to you because you are the vacuum for it. Your body, whatever requires, it puts like a vacuum. And whatever infection you're getting is because only of you. So, as we know, the acute disease classification, it is a rapid condition, rapid morbid process. It has a duration. It will end either in death or recovery. Okay. So this is mainly because transient explosion of latent sora. All of us are having sora within us, which is in the stage of latency. No man is, you know, one is not. Every one of us will be having a sora, which will be in the stage of latency. Okay. So how it will go into the stage of latency? That only which we call as health. No one is free of any miasm. So as we know in the aphorism number 72, individual sporadic and epidemic disease classification. So we know epidemic diseases, these are having similar suffering from the same cause. Okay, so what are epidemic diseases? All of us have an idea relating to that. It is similar suffering from the same cause. That's why it's called as an epidemic. Sometimes you have one condition which you get and you remain immune for rest of your life, okay, like chicken pox and all. It is very rare that it will reoccur in you, and there is something called as which keeps on reoccurring, like influenza or whatever, you know, every year you will fall sick of it. They are recurring, okay. So this gives an even idea of Hahnemann of those times speaking relating to the acquired immunity, okay. So relating to the totality of the epidemic, all of us know how we have to take any epidemic which comes, we have to take it as a new condition. We should again, you know, go into the epidemic details of every condition, how the fever is, and you know, we even know that the RNA, it keeps on manipulating and mutating. So we cannot cross check whatever Dr. Hahnemann has said that time. We can't strike it off because it is still valid till date. Because as they keep on, you know, modifying, mutating, so every epidemic should again be taken as a new one, okay. If this year, if you are getting next year, the new strain whichever are coming, again the symptoms has to be checked and should be taken as a new condition and has to be examined. If you are not going to examine it, definitely you are missing a lot on it because there is a mutation which is taking place. Maybe these words were not there those days, but it is directly applying to today. So there are certain experiences which I have faced relating to the COVID-19, and if you have any thing to ask me in between, you can definitely, because this was definitely cases which had come through one family and the other one through another family. So I have treated like two families, and this was in a curative aspect, and what are my difficulties and what I would be sharing with you all. So the first case is of an health worker, a 37-year-old female, presented with the complaints of fever with dry cough since 2 days. Patient is a surgeon who had visited in the ward for pre-op case history. Okay, so the patient of mine is a surgeon. She has her pre-op case history taking. So she had visited in a ward. So while she visited in the ward, most probably that patient would be, you know, infective, and she would have got it from there. After five days of the visit, my patient started presenting with fever and chills, which was aggravated in the evening. She had low grade fever throughout the day, that is 99 degrees, and profuse perspiration with complete lack of thirst. And the patient had dry cough, bouts of cough with very scanty, rusty sputum aggravation in the night time. And there was anosmia, which was seen in my patient, and she was unable to appreciate any smell, including jasmine flowers, coffee or whatever, and patient experienced a lot of prostration. So after 4 days of onset of symptoms, patient gave her samples and she was tested positive. After what were the altered physical generals were, she had decreased appetite, no thirst, perspiration was generalized, and sleep was disturbed due to anxiety. Patient was anxious because she has two children, and her husband and then her father and mother, they all are staying in actually very close contact, because father and mother also, they are very old, they are 70 plus. So my patient was very anxious that she would be transmitting this infection to her children. Once That is obvious, right? Because if anyone is positive, first thing we think is about our family. The same thing happened over here. My patient was extremely anxious. So based on the totality, first 30, I had prescribed 3 times a day for 4 days. So the temperature was 99 degrees. SpO2 was 99 to 100. We had checked it 2 to 3 times. Pulse oximeter, everyone had it. So 2 to 3 times per day, and respiratory rate was 18 beats per minute, breaths per minute. So follow-up criteria for me in this case was, what I used to assess every day was fever, anosmia, dry cough and prostration. I wanted these things to get better. Patient significantly improved with remedy. Within 3 days of prescription, patient was afebrile, dry cough, paroxysms were better, overall prostrations improved. Patient regained sense of smell after 11 days of my medicine prescription. It took time, and I got one more case even in that case. After 8 days, the patient regained. It goes comes gradually. It is not going to happen abruptly. So SpO2 and temperature were checked throughout the treatment on daily basis. That's 3 times per day. So this is first case. Case second and third, these are her children. They also got tested positive after from the mother. She went and got tested. They didn't have like lot of complaints. The only thing is, one child is 3-year-old, another child is 8-year-old. So she didn't have many complaints. So the child had fever with chills since one day. Night aggravation was there. Patient had increased thirst. Patient was restless during sleep. And patient was very cranky with marked lethargy. So she had, along with complaints mentioned, the other child had vomiting. And same symptoms were present. So it was a very simple prescription. I gave arsenic to my both the patients, both the children, and both were doing fine. Their SpO2 was normal, it was 100, and temperature was 99 to 100. In 3 days, these children were fine. Actually, from 2 days itself, they were like running around and they were fine. So there was no issue relating to this. So first and second category came into us, you know, very uncomplicated cases. Then the number four case was the lady's father. Okay, so I got an experience of all ages, like younger age, and this father is 77-year-old. So the biggest fear for her was relating to him, her father. He also got the same complaints, fever with dry cough since 2 days, and he came in contact with his daughter, who's a health worker. Fever with dry cough, night aggravation, low grade fever throughout the day, and frontal headache with heaviness. And there was dryness in mouth, throat with increased thirst, and the onset of fever, and there was constipation. So the patient is a known case of diabetes and hypertension. It's under control. So these all are the criteria which is, you know, which should make you extra cautious. You know, men are older, comorbid. Everything is there in this case. So with this particular things, I was little, you know, apprehensive relating to, you know, what I'm supposed to do with this case, whether this patient I will be able to do. And he is also a general medicine, he's a physician, so he also knows his own medicines, but still he preferred taking homeopathic medicines. Then based on the totality, bryonia was prescribed, and as I saw, like relating to so many things spoken in average about the diseases, this man, 77-year-old with comorbid conditions, did much better, got much better improvement than in other people. He was very, he had recovery very soon. Within 2 to 3 days, this patient was fine, and I followed this patient till 7th day and noted that there was no complaint. And because suddenly there would be shortness of breath or something like that would start from 7th day, but as such no complications occurred. And this person, within 3 to 4 days of the treatment, got fine. Now case number five is a complicated case for me, and I really got tensed in this case, and my colleague knows my thing, because every morning I came and spoke to Dr. Kalpavali relating to this case, because we were continuously discussing, and with my senior staff I used to discuss, because this was the case which really made me believe that no, I have to, you know, really go very slow with this case. A patient named S, age 41-year-old, retinologist by profession, presented with history of fever and chills with extreme anxiety since first day. from the time he got his symptoms, from first day onwards, he had anxiety, and this was aggravated at night, which was associated with chills, and temperature was 101. Sorry, I've not written there. And patient's fever. A patient was in extreme restlessness that he will be sent to ICU. Okay. From the first day onwards, he's a claustrophobic person, and this patient has fear of infectious diseases. Okay, this is what I got to know while we were discussing the case. So, and he had extreme fear of disease, and once admitted, he will not return home. Which remedy is it? Can anyone guess? Hopelessness of even cure after giving arsenic. Yeah. So the prescription is quite very simple. It was better than any other, right? So we got it very well. The patient's fever was rising high. It was 101, then 102, and which aggravated at night, and there was a complete exhaustion and cold sweat. Patient was extremely prostrated and ameliorated by warmth. Heat stage was burning, sweat stage, cold sweat, and followed by chills. So the patient had increased thirst associated with nausea, and even patient explained that he felt tightness of chest associated with shortness of breath. But while we were discussing, other all cases were doing fine. So I did not consider him at the first day, you know, that anything would be wrong. So I was like, it would be the panic. So maybe that's the reason he's feeling. Because when you're panic, you usually feel breathless, and I'm feeling little, you know, all this. So appetite was decreased, thirst was increased, sweat was cold, sleep anxiety. So later I got to know the second day, the patient is a known case of autoimmune pancreatitis. So first prescription was arsenic I had given to the case. Okay, for 2 to 3 days his fever was, you know, dropping down back to normal, but from, you know, almost third day the patient was not doing fine with this, and you know, again the the totality has changed again. So I had to go with belladonna water doses. For every 2 hourly I started giving that. So this particular complaint kept on, you know, continuing. Then on 6th day, the patient started having 100 to 101 with extreme exhaustion and restlessness. Fear had increased because he is a doctor. He knows that if the complaints start getting worse from 6th, 7th day, and you know, his SpO2 is dropping and all those things. So he had shortness of breath, which further led to panic. Patient was started on oxygen in home setup. The wife also is a doctor, husband, so they said that, you know, we'll get an oxygen saturator at home and we'll start with the treatment. So treatment was started, and then we thought that better let us go for a CT scan. This patient was even taking Dolo along with Bell. Dolo also was going on continuously, but he took only 3 times because he's scared of the side effects as well. Okay, that anxiety is there in him. And CT scan we got, there was opacity and all of this. Okay, so ground glass pattern was seen, and interleukin 6 was also ranging between 30. Okay, so this is a striking thing, because if it's going to increase, then there's going to be a cytokine storm. So I was scared relating to cytokine storm. Okay, so patient was not comfortable to be shifted to hospital. He was not at all agreeing with his wife that I will, because he thought if he goes, he won't come back, because he has past experience relating to being admitted in hospital for autoimmune pancreatitis. So 7th day, in spite of oxygen was given, SpO2 maintained was just 98 and respiratory rate was 26. So later it started dropping to 96. And on 7th day midnight, he had severe chest tightness in the chest and breathlessness, and fever was 99 to 100, respiratory rate was 30 breaths per minute. He was shifted to ICU. So patient saturation dropped to 94 with oxygen. Okay, these are all scary thing actually, because while we are giving our system medicines, and as well as something is going on, because I said that we will be able to do things fine. So this particular level, there is some medicine, I am not remembering the name of the medicine, flavirin, what is that, some 14,000 that medicine cost. So they were planning to buy this medicine, but it was not available in the market. So along with that, our belladonna is continuing. As soon as he takes belladonna, his fever was coming down, but other things were getting worse. So patient was shifted to ICU. There are medicines are not allowed, so we stopped it. Later, we put the the patient was put on steroids, oxygen, high nasal flow oxygen, 8 to 10 liters per minute was provided, and antibiotics were prescribed. Within 3 days, he came back. Then nothing happened to him. He came back after 3 days. So this was one of the cases wherein really I was scared, I was apprehensive, and I was not able to understand how to, you know, go ahead. And if they were not doctors, what I would have done and what I would have answered. So such cases come to us, and these are complicated cases. This is another case, which is these are the patients from Florida. Their mother passed away, and no, father passed away. So for the funeral, they wanted to come to India. And you know, while you're coming to India, definitely they're going to check. And they got tested positive on the airport, and they wanted to come back. Funeral, father's already dead. It is next day. They are waiting for the son to come arrive and to do the rituals. But what happened here is they are tested positive. That fear is there. Father, mother, and son, all three of them were together. So this patient was having all the common symptoms, like, you know, fever with dry cough, night aggravation, low grade fever. So this patient did not have a very, you know, serious complaint. This was like coming into the category of, you know, uncomplicated case without pneumonia. So this case, Bryonia was given, and patient did well. The only thing I was looking into is from day one his SpO2 was 97. So that's what, you know, kept me under caution whether it is fine or no, because we don't have any. These are all online consultation. We cannot see our patients. We are just doing online. So this Bryonia was given to the patient, and within 3-4 days the patient was better. From 7th 8th day looked into any seriousness is happening in the patient or not. He was okay. Then nothing happened. His wife also was tested COVID positive. She also had same complaints, but it was along with ear pain and anosmia. So this patient, after taking the totality, pulsatilla, you know, was prescribed. Even she had 97. So it made me believe whether the instrument is wrong or what, because they didn't have any other means. But otherwise, the patient was doing well, and this was a case of, again, an uncomplicated COVID-19. So in the criteria, so this helped me relating to, you know, knowing certain criterias, like what case can be taken, what case can be referred, and certainly I thought it would be helpful if I could share my experiences with you people. And I don't know whether I should be doing it or no, but like with the pressure of my husband, vitamin C and zinc was continuously taken by all the physicians all around. So that was going on in all the patients. And these patients did not take any allopathic medicines. They were purely in homeopathy. Those were all are surgeons and this. So they have taken Dolo. Two patients have taken Dolo. Other than that, this is my experiences. Relating to epidemic, Dr. Kalpavali will be speaking. We'll come back for the doubts or any questions to be answered together. Okay? Yeah. Thank you.